The date is December 12, 1996. The survivor is Vera Laska. Her last name at birth was Orovitz. The interviewer is Merrill Lunin. The city and state are Weston, Massachusetts, USA. The language of the interview is English.
My name is Merrill, M-E-R-Y-L. Last name is Lunin, L-O-O-N-I-N. Today is December 12th, 1996, and I'm conducting an interview with Dr. Vera Laska in Weston, Massachusetts, USA.
Can you state your name and spell it, please?
My name is Vera Laska. And what else?
And can you spell it?
L-A-S-K-A.
And your first name also?
My first name is Vera, V-E-R-A.
Okay. And what was your name at birth?
Orovitz, O-R-A-V-E-C.
And when were you born?
I was born in 1928.
The date?
21st of July.
And how old are you now?
Oh, don't ask nasty questions. Figure it out. 1928, 78, so I must be getting close to 70.
In which city and country were you born?
I was born in Košice, Czechoslovakia.
And can you spell Košice?
K-O-S-I-C-E.
Okay, great. Dr. Laska, how would you describe the home and neighborhood where you grew up?
Well, I grew up in a very interesting neighborhood because it was an ethnic mixture, which gave me, now that I'm looking back, gave me some kind of a good background to what was to follow in my career in the United States, because my family at home spoke Czech, the neighborhood was Slovak, the school was Slovak, although there were many Czech teachers. And there was quite a bit of minority among us of Germans and Hungarians.
So you spoke those languages as well?
Most kids. You know, in that Central European milieu, most people spoke several languages. Not like in the United States, where we have a continent that speaks one language, English. But there it's sort of mixed up. And the countries are so small that if you start jogging, you jog out of your country, you jog out of your language. So by necessity, you had to learn languages. And we had in high school, we had several languages, French, German, not mentioning Latin, which we had to take, which was very helpful in learning English later.
How would you describe your family's social position?
That is a very difficult question to answer, because my mother came from a very well-to-do and highly respected family, and when she was young, there was lots of money to go around, while after she got married and divorced, there was no money, so our home looked like $1 million with Persian rugs and what have you, but there was very little money.
What were you like as a child? Can you?
I must have been quite a character. Very strong-willed. My poor mother couldn't manage me. I always did what I thought is right, which wasn't necessarily always the correct thing. But I wanted to devote my life to sports. I originally wanted to be a professional athlete or swimmer or skier or something. Luckily, I must have seen the light later on and switched to being dreaming of becoming a teacher, which I did.
Was your family religious?
No, not at all.
Did you have any church affiliation?
No, I was born Catholic, but not practicing.
Did you have much interaction with Jewish families in Košice?
Yes, we did, because some of the elite in the town were Jewish and highly respected, such as lawyers or doctors. I remember our dentist was Jewish, our doctor was Jewish. I don't remember lawyer business, but I knew several kids in the swimming club or in school whose dad was whose fathers were lawyers and they were Jewish. Yeah. There was no prejudice. I tell you one thing. One of my closest friends as a teenager was a gal who happened to be Jewish, which I didn't know for years. For years I didn't know, until this Hitler business started and she made some comments. And I said, what's that to you? And she said, well, I'm Jewish, stupid. And so I didn't know. How should I know? So we grew up in a very happy ambiente, so to speak, mostly perhaps because the creator of the country, Masaryk, M-A-S-A-R-Y-K, was a philosopher and concentrated on ethics, and he was a humanitarian, and there was no way that we were taught being anti-Semitic or anti-anything.
Did your family have any political affiliations?
No.
Did you feel any? Were you discussing it with friends?
Well, we were discussing it, but I never was a joiner of any political party, not as a kid, not as a teenager, down to our days. I am not a card-carrying anything of any political party. I'm trying to do what is morally right. Or you can put me into a category of humanitarian or something like that. But definitely no political party. Nowadays, if I vote, I vote for the person, whether he's Republican or Democrat.
Were there any adults or extended family who were especially influential to you when you were a child?
Not really. I read a lot, and as I hate to repeat this business of President Masaryk, but I read much earlier than I should have, perhaps, all his works about what the meaning of life is and how people should behave. And that was, if there was a shining star for me to follow, it was he and his disciples.
What do you remember about elementary school?
Just about nothing. Strange, isn't it? I see the building of the school, but I would have trouble remembering the names of teachers. Oh, I remember one thing. They almost threw me out of first grade. I'm very proud of that. Because the reason was that I kept asking, and why, and where, and who. And so the teacher called it my mom and said, if that child will not shut up and ask those impertinent questions, we'll send her to reform school. And my mother cried. That was her reaction. And today, of course, as we look at it, I must have been a smart cookie. I wanted to know. But the teacher disagreed. So that's what I remember, first grade.
Did your mother work outside the home?
No.
And you mentioned that you had sporting as hobbies and interests. Can you talk a little bit more about that?
About sports?
About your sports.
Oh, you'll have hard times stopping me. Well, from childhood on, I loved water and swimming. So I became member very early in the child category, still member of the Czech Sports Club swimming division. And I spent every possible hour in the summer, didn't have winter pools at that time, at the swimming pool. Swimming, training, winning races, never lost a race, and just socializing. It was a wonderful period of growing up. In the winter, I had a different kind of a group, and we went skiing. And in between, we went kayaking on the river. And you see, Czechoslovakia, which is called the land of the Yankees of Europe, was very sports-minded and helped young people with sports. We had all kinds of lower rates in, not hotels, what would you call it, hostels for skiing and so on. So there were special trains that took our bicycles down the river over weekends only. And we went down by kayak or canoe. And coming back, again, we could put the kayak on the train, freight train, for peanuts, really, and bicycle back home. And this went on year by year, weekend by weekend. But mostly we knew the trails from hiking because that leads into our subject, you know, of smuggling people across the border and all that.
Did you have any particularly close friendships, either from the sporting groups or school?
I had many, many good friends. And I mean good friends, not in the superficial sense, you know, you meet somebody and he's a friend. I mean a friend who would take off his last shirt from his back or her back, and vice versa. Yeah, I had many good friends. And little by little, I'm losing them, of course.
Does anyone in particular come to mind from those years?
Oh, yeah, my closest friends was a gal by the name of Magda, who lived in the next house where I grew up. And her parents took out a piece in the fence and made two little steps, one on each side, so we could commute without going on the street. Dangerous, because every half an hour there was a car, you know. So, and that friendship lasted very long. As a matter of fact, she visited me in America. We invited her. She was in this house. And unfortunately, she's no longer with us. She was my very closest friend.
What was her last name?
Magda Kish, K-I-S-S.
What about secondary school? What do you recall about that?
Well, what about it? Again, we had lots of languages. In the whole, the system is slightly different than the American system, so what here would be middle school or junior high and high school is packed into one, and we had no choice in subjects, which I still approve of. That's what we need in our high schools in the States. We had 6 years of Latin, 4 years of German, 4 years of French. No choice. The only choice we had was typewriting and I don't know what else, sort of almost like extracurricular activities, but that was extra in the afternoon. Otherwise, 6 days a week, 8 to 1, and everything prescribed, so that we had a very thorough and good general education. You know, I teach American history here at Regis College, and we come to the frontier and frontier literature. And there is more that I did not forget from my high school in Czechoslovakia than these kids ever heard of, which is very sad, very sad. They don't know American literature.
What kind of school was it? Was it a public
school? Oh, yes, public school.
And was it all girls or mixed?
It was an all-girls school, yes.
Do you recall any anti-Semitic incidents when you were growing up at all?
Not that they would dovetail into our story, no.
How old were you when the war began?
Well, when the war began in Europe, I was 12 or 13.
And what do you remember? What were you hearing at that time?
Well, I remember anger. I saw, a few months before the war started, I saw the German army march into my country. And it was heartbreaking. It was very heartbreaking because all these ideals that we grew up with, freedom, truth shall prevail, all that went down the drain, you know, first of all by the treacherous behavior of France and England, who sold Czechoslovakia down the river at Munich. They sold out. Treaty, no treaty, you know. And so it was a very bitter moment. But life went on, and we still went skiing, and we still were swimming around. But it was very sad.
How did it affect you? Did it affect you at all in terms of what you couldn't do anymore? You just...
Not really, because as I said before, I wasn't politically active, and so I didn't give political speeches or so. And if we were cursing the Germans, we cursed the Germans in our closed company of friends, where just about everybody had the same feelings. But you had to start to watch your mouth when you were in public, let's say in a coffee house, or at intermission in a movie, because you never knew who stands next to you and might report you that you said that Hitler is an idiot or some grandiose statement like that.
What was your impression of the German soldiers?
Most of them that I remember got sick to their stomachs, because evidently when they came to Czechoslovakia, they saw for the first time in a long time whipped cream or good chocolate or what have you, and they just overate, and the hospitals were full of German soldiers who had their stomachs pumped out, at which point, of course, we rejoiced. And that leads me to mention a little episode during the war, what the resistance did. Put laxative in the coffee of the Nazis. And I thought this was a Czech invention, which is far from the truth, because I talked to people in Greece and Norway and points in between, they all did the same thing. The human mind works to a large degree the same way, nationality or no nationality. Very easy item on the list of resistors, put laxative in their coffee. Unfortunately, we didn't see the result, you know, how they were holding their tummies and running, you know. But that happened all over the place.
Were you aware at that point that things were starting to change for the Jews in your town?
I started being aware of that when they actively did something. I didn't see, for instance, well, I heard that in Germany, for instance, the Jews could not be doctors or lawyers or professors and so on. But it was sort of like when you hear thunder far in the background. I was too young to care, probably. And, you know, the town where I was given to Hungary, as at Munich, the Sudetenland was given to the Germans. And so the Hungarians said, and we want the southern part of Slovakia. So Košice went Hungarian. And the Hungarian Jews were relatively very lucky, because real serious trouble for life in Hungary didn't start until Eichmann came to Hungary on March 19, that's St. Joseph's Day, that's how I remember the date. And he started the ball rolling in Hungary. By that time, I was long gone, you know.
What were the circumstances that led to your involvement in the resistance?
You know, I sort of slid into it willy-nilly via sports, in a way, because a friend of mine was approached by the resistance, which was leading or organizing the Underground Railroad from Slovakia to Hungary, from Hungary to Yugoslavia, and so on. And she was approached and said, hey, there are some French prisoners of war who escaped. They didn't even say that, just two Frenchmen who want to get to Hungary, but they don't have papers. Would you lead them across the mountain? Do you think you could cross the border in the mountain so nobody would see? And my friend said, well, maybe, if a friend of mine could come too. I don't want to do it alone. And she asked me. And I said, sure, why not? But it wasn't like, this is the resistance, sign here, you know. So very casually, and after we did that, and it was successful, they said, well, would you do it again? Sure, we would do it again. So then we realized, hey, we are in the resistance. It was very, maybe I should admit that, but that's how it happened, you know. And not everybody was, rah, I'm going to join the resistance. And then we stayed. Now, that was our decision. And from then on, that we knew what we are doing, it's our merit, okay? But how we got into it is sort of, it was very casual. And then, of course, once we were in this enterprise of taking we call them Pierre, every Frenchman was Pierre. We took the Pierres over, which wasn't too difficult. I have a slightly funny description of that in my book, how we got them to try to teach them skiing. It was hopeless. So we created a gadget, And we have that gadget in the United States sold for good money. It's a piece of metal, and the child sits on it and goes, slides down the hill. Now, what is that called? I gave it, I don't know whether your TV camera can stand that, but I translated it in my book as S-LED. I don't want to spell that, but leave it to your imagination. So that's how we got them downhill and then uphill there to pull this gimmick or gadget. But then, of course, trouble started with the Jews in Slovakia. And so the Jews started fleeing. And evidently somebody from among the Jews contacted that resistance leadership. And so then they said, well, no Frenchmen this time, but there's a Jewish family. Would you take them? So they said, well, why not? Make no difference to us. And I think we must have looked at ourselves like, wow, look what we are doing. We are spiting Hitler, which is the basis of the resistance. And so from then on, we started taking Jews here and there. Another Frenchman got away from camp in Poland. But then we took Jews. And that, again, is in my book description what troubles we had with some of the people, passengers that we took.
How old were you when you were doing all of this?
Well, I was a teenager.
Were you one of the younger members?
Oh, definitely, yeah.
And were you treated differently as a result?
By whom?
By either the people you were smuggling or the other members?
No, I think that the people we were smuggling, the Frenchmen, were fun. And they didn't take their own fate seriously. They were prisoners of war, so that if they were caught, they were thrown back in the camp. That's it, you know. And the Jews were so worried that they couldn't care who the devil is helping them as long as we were helping them. Some of them asked, well, how old are you, dearie? We didn't answer. Or we said whatever. What's your name, Maria? You didn't give names away to, at least not real names, because next hour they can be captured and interrogated, and who brought you here, so-and-so, so we didn't give names.
Do you recall now the name of the friend who got you involved in the first place?
Yeah, Magda, another, that's a different Magda. It just so happened that was Magda.
And what?
I got her last name by now.
Did you continue to live at home during that time?
Sometimes yes, sometimes no, because many times either there was too much snow or too little snow, whatever, so we stayed on the Hungarian side at some safe house. But basically, yes.
Were you at all aware of the size and scope of the resistance activities, or who else was involved?
Well, I'll take your question literally, and then the answer is no. I found out after the war, many, many other things that I didn't know at that time. But you could have figured that if we are doing saving people or smuggling people across the border in, you know, Poland, Slovakia, Hungary, Yugoslavia, that there were similar things must have been going on in the West, which they were, also underground railroads and so on. I teach nowadays, so I know much more today than, much, much more today than I knew at that time.
And did you find out later who, either who the leaders were or what was the name of the organization?
There was no name. No name.
It was just Czech underground. Just
Czechoslovak it had to be. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Did you become
there
aware?
There were so many such lines that maybe in France or in Belgium, I know more today about details and names of the Belgian or French resistance underground railroad, then I know about the East for a very simple reason. Much more is written about it. And if anything, don't forget that Czechoslovakia was under communists, and barely anything came out unless they wanted it to come out, and they would enlarge or embellish certain aspects which had nothing to do with the Western Allies, for instance, only the Russian. And even that, I don't read Russian. I mean, I could read one sentence in 5 minutes, and I won't bother with that. So very little is today known about the eastern part of the resistance.
Can you describe the route that these people were taking? You were smuggling them over the border and then...
Yeah. Oh, I should have prepared a map. Well, you know Czechoslovakia is like a sausage, a long country with a head. I'm just thinking for 1 second if I have very handily a map. No, should I draw you a map? Or it's not necessary? Okay. Well, anyhow, the tail end is Slovakia. It's narrowing. And on top you have Poland. Now, where they came from in Poland, I have no idea. And then, so evidently there must have been some Poles involved when they got out, for instance, the Pierres, the Frenchmen, when they got away from the prisoner of war camp. And somebody got them through the border, which must have been very difficult because highly mountainous, you know, like the Rockies, the Tatra Mountains. And then they must have gotten to Prešov or nearby. And then somebody brought them across the border into Slovakia. And from the Slovak border, they took them to where we picked them up. We took them on the Slovak-Hungarian border. In Hungary, somebody else picked them. It's like a chain. And you usually knew one person where to contact. You know, or that person contacted you. I'm sending you two packages. One is a little bit torn, which means he limps or he's sick or something. But I hope you get them by Saturday. But I have to run now. It's almost noon. So I'll see you next time. So we knew 12 o'clock Saturday, and we knew where. We were told before where to pick them up at the railway station, or at the street corner, whatever. And then we took them over in the same way our group notified the next guy that two packages are on the way, or whatever, you know. No high secret writing or nothing like that. It was rather primitive, I think, but it worked most of the time.
We're going to stop for a tape change.
Okay.
Of an interview with Dr. Vera Laska. Dr. Laska, when you were smuggling people over the borders, did you have false papers?
Oh, yes. We had false papers for most countries, just in case.
Do you have any idea where those were made or how they were made?
Oh, yeah. Well, that was one part of the resistance, evidently, that manufactured false papers. False ID cards, false passport, false birth certificates, especially for Jews, and what else? Ration cards. You know, by the ton, I'm sure, if you added it all together. Because there were so many people in hiding, don't forget, it wasn't just the Jews who were running from persecution, but there were lots of people who were either part of the resistance or not part of the resistance, but suspected as part of the resistance, and they were persecuted too. So many of them went abroad, and many of them went into hiding or lived under false identities.
What were some of the names that you used?
The only name I really remember is Michalska, because I always liked that name, I don't know for what reason. And the others must have sort of come and gone, you know.
Can you describe some of the more eventful of the trips that you recall?
Oh, yeah, that I remember. Well, we had some strange encounters and we had some difficulties. For instance, people fleeing for their lives grab all kinds of strange things to lug with them, okay? So one thing I remember is a couple who had silver candelabra, very beautiful, I must say, if I remember correctly, and must have been very valuable, but very heavy. And we went on the mountains, you know, uphill, downhill, uphill. And they just go, oh, I cannot carry it, would you help me? And so then we decided that before we go, we will look what people have, and if it's silver candelabra, no way. One couple carried a teddy bear, which I so remember, just a little teddy bear, but that doesn't weigh so much. One woman came in high heels, and we said, please change your shoes. Well, she doesn't have other shoes. Said, you won't make it. And you cannot go shoeless because of stones and what have you, or it was winter or whatever. And we had trouble with the husband. He gave us help, you know. And so I remember there was a sharp exchange of words because he said something like, we are paying you, so you do as I said. And I said, no, you're not paying us. Nobody's paying us nothing. We are risking our necks. So no high heels. We didn't take them. We didn't take them, and somebody later, somehow, I seem to remember, somebody else took them, but no high heels. I mean, you go across the mountains in high, and I mean high heels, beautiful high heels. So that was one part. And there's a sexy story in my book with the Frenchman, but I'm just indicating what happened, and I don't really know whether it happened because I didn't hold a candle. But one of the Frenchmen and one of the guides, we were waiting in the woods for time to pass to catch a certain train, not to be too early at the station. And they sort of disappeared in the woods, and I don't really know what happened. But so that's my sexy story in the book. The Frenchmen were fun. They were really fun. At one point, some Frenchmen got stuck. I forget what happened to the line. And we had them for about a week. And it's amazing, we just took them, you know, to the coffee house, no papers, we must have been so stupid. And we took them skiing, and it was wonderful.
Where were the Frenchmen trying to go?
Well, the line went, as I mentioned, from Poland finally to Yugoslavia, from Yugoslavia by train to Beirut, Lebanon, which at that time was a beautiful place. I had never been there. But I got postcards saying, we ski in the morning, we swim in the ocean in the afternoon. That remained so much in my mind, such a miraculous place. And then they went by ship in the Mediterranean to a city called Agde, A-G-D-E, in southern France. And, of course, after France fell, then the line avoided France, went directly to England. That's how it went. And, of course, the Frenchmen first wanted to get home, and then after France fell, they went to England, and there they had the choice. They didn't have to join de Gaulle's Free French. And that was the line, of course, through which the Czech boys went to join the Czech army in Czechoslovakia. Army in exile in Great Britain. They were in British uniforms, but had Czechoslovakia here around the shoulder, inscription, you know, embroidered inscription. The same, and there were free Danes and free Norwegians and free Poles and I don't know what else. Most of the occupied countries had an army in exile or governments in exile. So that was the main purpose of these underground railroads.
Do you, were any of the people that you smuggled prominent?
I have no idea. You didn't ask names, and we were told two, and that's it. The Frenchmen we knew somehow. If they gave us real names, I don't know.
And the Czechs, there was one incident where that.
Well, the Czechs were somewhat different because they were like brothers and sisters, but you forget names. you know, from one transport to another. At one part of the underground, I was stationed in Yugoslavia, in Belgrade, in the Czechoslovak house, so-called. And we had once or twice a week a transport of anywhere from 25 to 50 young men, Czechs and Slovak, going to join the army against Hitler. So there were very few names that I remember, but there were two boys I somehow remember more than anything else, and I think that I mentioned them in the book. And I think I told you over the phone, such a miraculous thing happened just 2 days ago. Was it 2 days ago you called me up? Somebody sent me a clipping about them, about those two boys that I so well remember. We went through the border together from Hungary to Yugoslavia, and I remember going around Belgrade with them. I knew them for 3 or 4 days, and then they left with the transport. And I had a couple of postcards and nothing else. They were 17 years old, didn't finish high school yet. And the town from where these two boys were in the Czech part of the country somehow remembered them at the 50th anniversary of, I forget what is, well, there are so many 50th anniversaries now, and gave them honorary diplomas. And the two photographs are there as they are already soldiers. And that was sort of, I don't know, it really shook me up, those two boys. And they both fell in 1942. They were dead.
What were their names?
One was Jan Holub, and the other one was Jan, I forget now. I should have the clipping. Would you like to see? Maybe when we change tapes.
What were some of the dangers that you were up against on these trips?
Well, the danger was to be caught by the border guard, you know. But first of all, you know, you must realize this Central European mishmash and the geographical move of the border. So you have suddenly Hungarian border guards on skis. You know Hungary, the puszta, flat like your hand? And so they were taught skiing in, I don't know, two easy lessons, and they didn't know from Adam how to ski. And we were, several of us were racing skiers, you know. We could go right and left and up and down, and we knew the terrain, which those border guards didn't. So they were no match for us. Not mentioning that we were very careful to be told somebody else was watching the border guards when they are patrolling. And whenever they were patrolling, we went 5 minutes right after, you see, and at night. So that we didn't have any trouble from those border guards. And if they would have caught us, we had these papers, as long as they didn't strip us, we could talk ourselves. Oh, I must mention that we all spoke both languages, fluent, no accents. And that is a very important part of the story. And maybe takes away a little bit from the heroism of the whole thing, because if you didn't speak the language, you were lost. Then you are suspicious. Then you're a foreigner.
Did you have any close calls?
No, not in this part of my activities, but I had a scare. I had a terrible scare one night when, for some reason which by now I don't remember, I was coming back from Hungary alone. Because usually we were two or three together. This was alone. And it was dark, of course. And as I was crossing, let's say, from this place to the highway that you see there, I saw somebody standing next to that tree, maybe smoking a cigarette. For a moment, I saw a flicker of light. And that person was standing there motionless. But I saw it's a soldier because it had a belt and something like a gun, and I stopped, and I didn't enter the meadow. There's a meadow, forest. And I was standing there, I'm telling you, must have been eternity, probably 3 hours or so, not daring to move because if I moved, that soldier would shoot me. Didn't dare to run. Then finally it became light and there was nobody there. It was what I saw, the flickering, must have been, somebody explained to me later, fluorescent, a rotting matter sometimes is fluorescent. And my imagination, putting that together, it looked clearly, clearly like a soldier. And I was scared out of my wits. That was pretty horrible. And ever since I said, I don't want to go alone, I want to go with somebody. Because it was really scary. Because I knew if I move, I'll be shot. Nothing happened.
During the time that you've described, you were still working from your hometown, is that correct?
Yeah, more or less, most of the time, yeah.
Was your mother aware of your activities?
No. My mother would have fainted or done something like nice ladies do, hearing about that.
Did anybody know? Anybody?
Well, my friends knew who were in that group. Nobody else. No other friends knew, because we were taught, you keep your mouth shut. Can you do that? Who is your best friend? Would you tell? No. And some of my best friends were in that group of 5 or 6. Sometimes we were 5, sometimes we were 6.
How did you receive your instructions? Who gave them to you?
One in our group was the contact. I wasn't the contact. I had some very interesting experiences, aside from the smuggling in Belgrade, where we had this original center of gathering place of these young, mostly men, 99 out of 100 were men and one woman, who were fleeing the way I described to you through the Mediterranean to join the Czech army. We had all kinds of apartments rented for them because they had to wait 2-3 days in Budapest or in Belgrade in the Czechoslovakian house. And in Budapest, while they were in these hired apartments, we didn't tell the Hungarians that they were Czechs, because, again, you have to know the Central European mishmash. The Hungarians didn't like the Czechs, but they liked the Poles for historical reasons, you know. So we said, these are Poles, Polish refugees. So, of course, the Hungarians didn't know the difference when they heard the language. Polish, Czech was all the same to them. And so I would go from one apartment to another to check if everything is all right, or take ration tickets, or take medicine, or take somebody to a dentist, or whatever. That's when I was a messenger, I think would be the closest. And at one place I arrived, and the boys are saying, oh, we are in trouble, we are in trouble. The landlady wants us to sing the Polish national anthem. No idea about the Polish national anthem. So... No problem. You all know the song Cikanka, the gypsy girl, which was an old sort of, popular song. Yeah, so slow it down, make a sad face, and sing Cikanka. So we all stood there, the boys stood as if, in practically saluting, and we sang this popular song. I should come up with some equivalent in English. Some silly song, like, how much is the doggy in the window, sad face. The equivalent about the gypsy girl and her love. And the Hungarian landlady was satisfied, a beautiful Polish anthem. And the crisis was over. Yeah, I still remember that. And I was worried that the boys will, burst out laughing or something, but they didn't. And then we went down Hungary to Yugoslavia, and that was the most touching part, really, because the Yugoslavs knew about this underground railroad. The border guards knew, and they were expecting us, and they were behind the border line waiting for brother Czechs to come, and they took us to some, what do they have, little house that the border guards have. And they had cots for us, and they had hot tea for us and food and blanket. And when we crossed into Yugoslavia, I remember, I wish I could design, I have two left hands, this huge Yugoslav border guard with his mustachios hanging down, coat down to his ankles. This is January, bitter cold, and saying, "Welcome to freedom, brother Czechs." You know, I could cry now when I think of it. And now look what they are doing in Yugoslavia now. You know, it's very sad. It's very sad. But that was wonderful because the Hungarians were paid guides, and they betrayed us at least on that occasion, if not more. And they said, "See those woods? That's Yugoslavia." So, and then they left us. You go alone, you know, over the meadow to the woods, which is Yugoslavia, which was a lie. It was still Hungary. But they were afraid to go so close to the border, the paid guards. So we went to the woods and started hollering, "Hey, we made it, we made it, we were still in Hungary." And then there was a wire that they said, "Watch out, there's a wire, you have to step over it." So we stepped over the wire, but of course we removed the wire, and that wire was ringing at the Yugoslav border patrol, whatever you call it, house or barracks or whatever. It was just a two-room shack affair. And so they knew, oh, here they are. And that's when they put on their coats and came out and said, "Welcome to freedom." Oh, very interesting. I wish I could... I wished after the war to get hold of some of those Hungarian guides who really tricked us. They took the money and left.
What kind of places did you live in, and who did you live with in the various places that you stopped?
Well, in Belgrade it was very simple because the Czechs had their own house. You know, it was a Czech ethnic minority in Yugoslavia, and they put, you know, their money together, and they actually built a house which had a big hall for dances or theater or whatever. And there, instead of the dance hall, they put cots down for the boys, and there were a couple of rooms, I don't know, might have been dressing rooms or what, and there were about 20 of us girls at that time in the Czechoslovak house. That I remember so well, and the address and the number. Went back after the war. Of course, all the employees were gone. There were other people by that time. But I remember the street and the number. So that's where I lived. And in Budapest, I was in one of those rented apartments with some other people.
What was the address in Czechoslovakia? What was the address in Czechoslovakia?
The address?
The address that you
in
recall.
Budapest.
I'm sorry, not in Budapest, but the Czechoslovak house.
Garašaninova 39, I still remember it in Serbian. Mm-hmm. Number 39, Garašanin Street, yeah. It's still, at least it was still there a few years ago when I was there. I don't know how many Czechs live there. Now everything is different. I was there before, I mean still under Tito, yeah.
How many trips total do you think that you made?
I was often trying to figure it out. Definitely under 24, and definitely more than 12. So pick your number in between. I don't know. It's so frustrating to me. I feel that I am sort of a historian, and I don't remember some of the most important dates in my own life. At that time, I couldn't care less. I don't know the date when I liberated myself, or the name of the village. I don't see how I could have been so stupid. Nothing, write it down or something, I don't remember.
And what happened to put an end to these activities, or what happened to you next?
Well, what happened to me next? Next happened that somebody evidently spoke or talked when they were not supposed to. So that our group was endangered, and out of the six of us, three somehow smelled the rat and disappeared, saved their necks, and three were taken to concentration camps. That's what happened. So it was very important not to talk.
before that, you were living in Belgrade, is that right? And you lived,
yes.
And you lived through the bombing?
Yes.
What was
yes.
that like?
April 6th, that I remember, because that was Easter Sunday. And the Saturday before, we went out on the town. We went to some, not nightclub, it's sort of a wine stube, if you know what that is. You order a glass of wine and stay for hours on the price of that wine. You could dance. And we went home, it must have been 2 o'clock at night. And as we were walking on the street, there were about six of us or more, we saw a sort of army marching, you know, in the direction of out of town. And one of us knew evidently a soldier, because they were shouting back and forth, "Hey, where are you going?" And the soldier was saying, "We're the last ones out of Belgrade," because Belgrade was declared an open city several days before that, which meant no bombardment. So that thousands, tens of thousands of Serbians, especially women and children from the surrounding area, came to Belgrade to stay wherever they could, because it's an open city. And that also means by international law, all military must pull out, okay? So he said, "We are the last ones out of Belgrade." So we went home, we went to bed, and I woke 10 minutes before 7 that Easter Sunday, and I had a little balcony at my rented room. And I looked out from that balcony, and at that moment I saw a bomb going boom, about, I would say, half a mile from us, where was the newspaper Politica, which is the biggest paper in Yugoslavia, and went up. Yeah. The open city by Nazi standards. They bombed Belgrade to smithereens. Yeah. So, but they rebuilt it after the war.
And can you describe your arrest? Where were you? What happened?
Well, it was very simple, as a matter of fact, because they caught me on the street. ID, please. They looked at the ID and said, "That's a false ID," which I knew, of course. And we were taken to the... I was taken to the police, and there I met my two friends.
And this was
for
where?
For a few moments.
What? I'm sorry, this was where? In which city?
This was in Košice. And we were in jail for several weeks, not many, less than a month. And then there's one day they just took us in a car, as a matter of fact. I don't know where they got a car, to the railway station and stuck us into a train, and that was it. And we ended up in Auschwitz.
What was that train like, going to Auschwitz?
Well, you must have read so many times about cattle cars and what have you. And we took about 3 days. It's all along Slovakia and then a piece of Poland. The interesting thing about Auschwitz and the location, everybody, quote-unquote, knows that Auschwitz is in Poland. But the irony is that Auschwitz at that time was in Germany, because of the movement of the borders and because the Germans annexed Western Poland to the Reich. And Poland was only the general government in the middle. So what was the question? How was the arrival?
Talk about the train ride.
Oh, the train, yes. Well, no food, no toilet facilities, barely a place to sit down. Although the train had some compartments, you know, for humans, but that probably was taken up by the German police. I don't know. I didn't go through the train. But where we went, it was pretty miserable and smelly and dark and people screaming and crying and cursing, but mostly no food and no water. And it was very shameful. Don't forget, I was a very young girl and I was ashamed to go to the bathroom in front of all kinds of people I didn't know.
Who was in the car with you?
other resistors, smugglers, black marketeers, you name it, the scum. We were part of the scum. And the arrival at Auschwitz was like a phantasmagorical picture that you read in, I don't know, 1984 is a fairy tale compared with it. It was dark, it was night, or it was too early in the morning so that it was dark, and you saw the fires going out of the chimneys. Not smoke, you didn't see the smoke because of that, but you saw the fire. For a long time after the war, when we went somewhere or drove somewhere, and there was a factory, an innocent factory, with the fire coming out the chimney, I always remembered that first moment in Auschwitz. And the stink, cannot call it smell, stink, as if hair was burning or flesh was burning, I don't know. And the shouting, it was a madhouse. And the zebras around, the zebras. I'm sure everybody was in shock. I'm sure. And this German standing there with his riding crop, it must have been Mengele, we didn't know. And dividing people, just like when the Jewish transports arrived. Same thing. For all I know, the train might have been a whole Jewish train with one additional, you know. Like Eichmann said, if you ever read Eichmann's reports, he would say, I'm sending so many cars of Jews, and attached is another car of gypsies. And attached is another car. He never said political prisoners. Vagabonds or Verbrecher, what's the word in English? Anyhow, professional no-goodniks, you know.
I'm going to stop you there for a tape change. With Dr. Vera Laska. Dr. Laska, you were talking about your arrival in Auschwitz and the selection process. What happened to you?
Well, the usual procedure, they cut our hair, all hair, on your head, pubic hair, under your arms. They took away everything you had. I mean, I remember clutching some photographs in my left hand. I don't know where I got them from, my purse probably. And everything taken away, and we had a shower, no gas, shower, real shower. And afterwards we got lager clothes. I never had a zebra. I had a gray shirt-like dress, like a blouse, but it went to my knees. And some girls got the same gray dress, no belt, just a button here. That was, I don't know, five sizes too big. Others got one that they could barely get into, so it was big changing. And I had such gorgeous shoes, handmade, the luxury of my life at that time, handmade shoes. And of course, those were gone. And I didn't get clogs. Most people got clogs, you know, those wooden shoes, very hard to walk in. I admire these kids who these days it's very fashionable, but evidently they are made differently. I never tried them. I wouldn't wear them if you gave them to me. But I got some miserable black high shoes, you know, to my ankle. And they were slightly small, no stockings, no underwear, no nothing. And we looked at each other, we didn't recognize each other, it was horrible. And then they took us to our block, which is the barracks, called them blocks. And later on I found out that these blocks were for about 450 to 500 people. We were 1,450, give or take 5%. I never counted really. Three to a cot or to a space. So-called mattresses, so-called straw mattresses, you know, that material that potato sacks used to be made of before nylon was invented, okay? A very rough kind of material. And was supposed to have straw. I don't know how many inches, but there was no straw. I don't know whether the lice ate the straw or whatever, but there was no straw. So it was hard, it was very hard. And literally, if we wanted to turn, everybody had to turn, because otherwise there was no space. Many times we slept this way, meaning my head was between two pairs of feet and my feet were between two heads on the other side. Three levels. Somebody told me that they started with two levels, then business got too good, so they built the third level. And I was on the third level through sheer luck, which was an advantage, because if you were on the lower levels, then many times when people would go to the bathroom, it would all fall down on the second level or from the second level to the first. It was really unbelievable. How did we? And we lived, we survived. Very few suicides in all concentration camps. Very few. Interesting. Life is precious. If only people would be aware of that.
Can you describe some of the other people who were in your block with you?
Oh, I tell you, there was one gal by the name of Lily. I had no idea about her last name, never knew. And she was feeble-minded. And she had the best time of us all. Because when we stood uphill, five in a row and don't move, okay? She would step out and start sort of dancing around and singing around, and her nose was running. And she was menstruating, which none of us were. Thin girl, nuts. She didn't know where she was. She felt like dancing, she was dancing around. And the Germans favored her because Lily was entertainment. And last year I got hold of a book, I don't remember the name or title. The first time somebody wrote a book about how these strange, slightly nutty people survived. The clowns of the camps. Well, finally, eventually she went up the chimney. But, you know, she survived for so long. And the Germans would give her the best of the soup. Or sometimes even bring her, I don't know, a piece of bread. Come on, Lily. You know, like you say, hey, Fifi. And you whistle to your dog. They say, hey, Lily, come on, dance. And she did. And she smiled. Her ugly teeth. She's smiling. So this is one inhabitant, one colleague. Across from me was Jadzia, a Polish girl, the Polish resistance. And once in the blue moon, when nobody else could hear us, we would exchange, you know, I don't know how we found out about each other, by smelling or how, that what Jadzia did and what I did, and we had some similarities in our activities and so on. That was Jadzia. Then there was one girl who had a beautiful voice, I mean a God-given beautiful, extra beautiful voice, and she would sing. And her favorite song was Jealousy. And I learned at that time Jealousy, I think, in about three languages, because other people knew the same song, not English. And so I remember her singing. Then there was a whole cooking group, very important, and I mean seriously, very important. It sort of kept up morale because we tried to tell about a book we remember, just sort of entertain each other, to talk about sane things in life, because we were living through insanity. And this cooking group would cook and would say, well, take 2 eggs. No, the other said, you must take 3. There was a big fight, 2 eggs or 3 eggs, you know. No eggs, it's right, of course. And they would make the dumplings finally in about 10 minutes, they made the dumpling. Then they would serve the dumplings and describe the plate and the pattern of the plate, and this fork is a little bit bent, and but the dumpling, the Czech national dish, the dumpling, fruit dumplings, and the butter, and how the rivulets of the butter float down the side, and whoops, here that one drop of butter got stuck, but the next one came and pushed it down. And the breadcrumbs, and how you make the breadcrumbs, what you use to make the breadcrumbs, you know, and so on, and so on. And the rest of us were sitting there, you know, our mouths watering because we were constantly hungry, of course. But this cooking business is not special to my experience. That went on everywhere, even among the men. They were also, quote, unquote, cooking, everyone. It, looking back, now that I survived, you know, everything, it's very interesting. The story I wanted to tell, and I tried to make it very short, about what life is all about. After the war, I went back to this little town, not little, just town, where I used to go to the milk bar would be the closest in English concept. They were selling yogurt or milk, and some sweets, you know. And I had my sweet and had my yogurt, and I go to pay, and there's the same gal who was there before the war, Maria, whatever her name was. And I said very casually, paying my bill, well, Mary, where were you during the war? And she said to me, right here, dearie, right here. And I said, thank God. I wouldn't switch with her. With Auschwitz, with everything else, I wouldn't switch with her. 5 years or more, she sat on that orange crate or what, so her feet wouldn't get cold, saying, 250, thank you very much, come again. 350, thank you very much, come again. No. So it all depends. Somebody would be very unhappy with my life and happy with Mary's life, saying, 250, thank you very much, come again, in the milk bar. So, the meaning of life or the purpose of life.
What did they give you to eat in Auschwitz?
Well, at one point, at the lowest point in Auschwitz, not in the other camp, somebody in the know said, 890 calories a day, which is very hard to believe until you will hear what it was. In the morning, a liquid, brownish in color, that came sometimes under the title of coffee, sometimes under the title of tea, but it was always the same damn thing. And very seldom was it warm. It was supposed to be warm, but by the time they brought it, I don't know, half a mile from the kitchen, in huge cauldrons, two women had to bring it. That's it. Then came lunch. We got a piece of bread. I don't know how many ounces, but it was like a slice of, the size only, size of a slice of American bread. I don't know how many ounces that would be. But not soft white bread, but heavy. And first you looked at it from both sides and see who is there, you know. Because sometimes there was pieces of cockroaches, or everything went into it. And some claim that it was sawdust mixed with the flour. I don't know. I ate it. I ate everything that was edible. And with that, we got sometimes a pat of butter or margarine, I imagine, margarine, or a pat of marmalade, or maybe once or twice we got a slice of a salami with the radio, with the, what is it called? The, not the radius. What is two radiuses? Anyhow, how wide a circle is? Maybe inch and a half, thin, just barely. You got a taste. That was it. And in the evening, it was more was soup. Sometimes for lunch it was soup. Sometimes for evening it was soup. And the soup was warmer than the coffee. And if we were lucky, we got something from the bottom because all kinds of things were swimming in the soup. Potatoes, potato peels, which was very funny because lately we found out, no, that the potato peels should be eaten. And a few years ago, for the first time, I saw in the frozen goods in American grocery supermarket potato peels. And I started laughing loud. People looked, what the hell is she laughing at? And I just couldn't stop. That potato peels, I said, hey, Auschwitz, they learned something. Anyhow, so potato peels or some vegetable, maybe a carrot, maybe some other vegetable that they got hold of. But, you know, these things sink down. And there was the capo who was distributing with a sort of half globe shaped dish she was distributing. Sometimes she had a ladle. And she would take it from the top, so you got nothing swimming. And when Lily came around, then she would reach lower. Or she would say, Lily, wait until I get to the bottom. And there were the goodies, the potato peels or vegetables or whatever. Meat, very seldom. Then when we were in Grossrosen and where we were on work commando, we got better food. Also, that was already 44, 45, and the Germans were getting a hell of a beating, and the moment the news from the front was bad for the Germans, we were better off because the German supervisor suddenly became human and brought us a piece of bread, or maybe a half-rotten apple, or a potato. No. We could tell how the war is going by the behavior of the German supervisor. When they started kicking us and cursing us and being rough with us, we knew the Germans are winning again. Maybe just one battle. And when the tide turned, suddenly there were nice insurance, you know, I took out insurance. I brought a prisoner an apple. I'm not a Nazi.
Can you describe what the appels, the roll calls, were like at Auschwitz?
Appels? Yeah. Well, first of all, they started at dawn. Most of the time it was still dark. And that was true in Auschwitz. That was true in the tunnel, all over the place. I think they woke up at 5. And then appel started at 6 for no good reason, because we didn't start marching to a factory except maybe a few minutes before 7, and work started at 7. And the joke is really that the German supervisors had to get up too with us. So I don't see why they didn't change that. But anyhow. And then we worked in the factory, and we had about half an hour for so-called lunch. And then we continued, and you add up 7 and 12 is 19. No. 7 and 12 is 19, which means 7 p.m. We didn't work till 7 p.m. So it must have been just an 11 hour, because I remember at 6 it was end and we came back to the barracks. And there was dinner at the barracks.
This was in Auschwitz? Or that?
No. Unfortunately, I wasn't on a work detail in Auschwitz. Luckily, I didn't know at that time that that's dangerous. No, the work detail was in the two other camps.
So what did you do during the days
at Auschwitz? We were just hanging around. Very dangerous, very dangerous. And we were, if they needed some occasional work, they would come and say, I need 50 to clean this latrine. I need 100 to move the stones or whatever, you know. And that was very dangerous, because then when they need space, these not assigned commandos go first to the gas chamber for no other reason than we need the space. Weeding out, you know? like I weed out my library or you weed out your garden. No, but in Groshausen, and I worked in a textile factory. And that was, didn't I describe that to you over the phone? Because I recall somehow that not long ago I described those big spools like that.
I'm going to bring you back to Auschwitz for a moment. Can you describe a little bit more what your, well, did you have interaction with other types of prisoners, with Jews, for example?
Oh, yes. Well, yeah, because the next whole block from me on one side was Jewish prisoners, and the other side were non-Jewish prisoners. And I'll come back to the Jews in a second. It was interesting that other block, they had little windows, and I talked to some women, older women, and you could tell they were country women, not city folk, from Lidice. And so I'm one of those few who talked to the women of Lidice in Auschwitz, because everywhere you read that the Lidice women were taken to Ravensbrück, which is true, but evidently some were taken to Auschwitz. I talked to them. Anyhow, so on the other side were Jewish women, Jewish prisoners. And there was a sort of a yard, open space in between blocks, maybe as wide as twice this room. And so we could talk. We could talk. And they had a harder time, because they lived with, where is my husband, where is my child, where are my parents, you know, which was one trouble we didn't have.
Were you aware that you were being treated any differently from any of the other prisoners?
No, not really, except over them constantly hang the danger, the gas chamber, constantly. And with us, it was sort of mezzo-mezzo. We might not. You know, several hundreds of thousands of non-Jews went up the chimney. The first people went up the chimney were non-Jews. The test. You know. And the damn chimneys were there constantly, and the soot was falling on us. On the third floor cot where I was, where my space was in the barracks, there was a little opening, maybe this big, with some wiring, but I could see it out. And I could see one chimney, and I could see parts, you know, like an inch here, an inch there, of the road from the railroad station to the chimney. And on several occasions, the time coincided that I was on my cot and looked out, and there were groups of people in dress, you know, I mean, in clothing, coming from the station, going to the gas chamber. And that is the reason why I'm saying this and many other things that we observed, of course, in Auschwitz, is the reason that the best testimonials about the Holocaust, about confirming, yes, there was a Holocaust and none of this idiotic nonsense, there was no Holocaust. Well, the lunatic fringe is here. We are the best witnesses, because we are the so-called objective witnesses. We are not Jewish, but we saw it. You know, not mentioning the Sonderkommando, which sometimes was Jewish and sometimes was not Jewish. And some of them survived and wrote their memoirs. So this lunatic fringe, and I thought that by now they stopped, but they don't.
What was your block number? What block were you in?
I think it was block 4, but I wouldn't swear to it. Very low number. I think the Lidice women were 3, we were 4, and the Jews were 5, but I'm not sure. You know, I went back to Auschwitz, and I was absolutely lost. Birkenau, really, not Auschwitz. Because the barracks don't stand anymore. They had to take them down, so they say. And they have one or two of those, we call them blocks, and nowadays they call them barracks, left. And I went in, and it didn't look like my barrack. There was lots of brickwork. I mean, there is lots of brickwork in those sample blocks. We didn't have any brick. I'm positive. And at that time, I still had a friend who was with me there, And I called her over the phone. I said, you remember bricks? And she said, what bricks? No bricks. So they left evidently some better barracks or rebuilt them, I don't know. But all those dozens of barracks, have you been to Auschwitz? Oh, yeah. So you know, the chimney, little chimney parts are sort of sticking out of the grass. Okay? I don't know, dozens upon dozens. I couldn't find my block. And I didn't see where was the Lager Street, nothing. It was very, very strange. That, you know, I said, I'll never forget that. And I couldn't locate it. I couldn't, absolutely couldn't locate it, whether it was on this side or that side.
Did you have a number?
Yeah, I had a number.
Do you remember what it was?
I used to remember 5-digit. I know that the end was 979. I like those numbers. But I don't remember the whole number. Maybe it was 31. I don't really remember.
You mentioned that you had a friend who survived. Did you make any particularly close friendships in the, that you remember?
Well, you know, when you are in jail, ask any jailbird in the war or outside. They are the types of friendship that are very special. And we maintained contact for a long time with the four of us. The four of us out of the five stood appel whenever possible together. But, you know, most of those are gone. One is still alive in Yugoslavia, of all places. And we are in touch. We are in touch. Her name is Vera, too. So she was Verice, which means little Vera. And I was Vera.
And what were their names?
Vera Kershaw. She's in the book. Chapter is about her. Very interesting. Somebody should write a book about her life. More incredible than a soap opera. With a happy ending, except he just died last year. And I cannot talk about it because she's alive and they are very intimate things, but you read part of it, you read in the book because she approved what's in the book.
And the other people that were of the four, do you remember their names?
Well, I might remember the names, but they are also, you know, dead. One whose name I don't remember, I don't know why, we called Little Current. She was, I don't know, she didn't know. How old are you? I don't know. I don't think she knew what it means to be so old or so young. She was a little thing like Mercury, you know. Lively eyes. She must have been 12 or so, or maybe 11, but she was a child. When I was 12, I was not a child. I could think. She didn't know how to read and write. Romania. How she got to that woman? And I taught her, I tried to, you know, the teacher, in the dust of the that little yard between the block, taught her numbers and taught her how to read. And then I drew her a picture of a clock, because in one place, not in Auschwitz, that was after Auschwitz, in Gross Rosen, there was a clock. We could tell what hour it was. Big deal. And I taught her how to read the clock. And I told the little idiot how to find me after the war. She loved me. She thought I'm the Katzmir. And she was the best organizer of all of us. She could steal that you wouldn't believe. She would steal the eyes out of your face and potatoes and whatever. And I told her how to find me after the war. Two of them were, the three of us were so young, but I was the grown-up youngster and they were the kid youngster. And the other one, this Yugoslav girl, was an intelligent girl, and she remembered, you know, the university address in Prague, and she wrote to me, and ever since we are in touch. And she was here, and I was there. And this other one, this Romanian, disappeared. So I hope that she found some family, or I don't know.
When did you leave Auschwitz?
I left Auschwitz on my birthday in 1944. And that was very interesting. They always asked for volunteers, which is sort of a strange thing in Auschwitz, ask prisoners for volunteers to work in a gardening outfit or in a candy factory, you know, all the goodies. And of course, we didn't believe what they are saying. And in Auschwitz, whatever you volunteered for was 50%, the other 50 being the chimney, you know, weeding out for the chimney. So then I said, if they will ask for volunteers on my birthday, I will volunteer. Because I figured few people die on their birthdays. Now, whether that is statistically probably true. Do you know anybody who died on their birthday? Adams and Jefferson died on the birthday of the United States, the same day. Same day. Did you know that? July 4th. Very interesting. Anyhow, so then came again volunteers. We need volunteers for a textile factory. My birthday. I volunteered. And with me, our appel row and some, a whole bunch of us volunteered. And we won. The 50 went out of Auschwitz rather than up the chimney. But could have gone any other way. And that's how I got marched out of Auschwitz gloriously. And we saw color for the first time in a long time. Because Auschwitz was not even gray. You know, gray can be beautiful. You know the color of mud? It's not gray. It's sort of a tannish gray, no? That's the color of Auschwitz. The barracks, our uniforms, mostly the mud or the dust, or the snow when it became dirty.
Where were you taken?
And we went by train, I mean real train, we could sit. We went to Gross Rosen. And Gross Rosen is, how should I tell you? You know where Dresden is in southeast Germany, former East Germany? So that neck of the woods, okay? Now, Gross Rosen is the center. And what I didn't know until a few years ago when East Germany was freed and my husband and I went to all these concentration camps in former East Germany, so I went back to Gross Rosen. Beautiful memorials and what have you, museum. And what I didn't know until I saw in the museum there a map, and there was Gross Rosen, 63 subdivisions, 63, that's more than Auschwitz. Auschwitz had, I think, 39. So I was in one of those 63, and we were taken to a textile factory. And actually, it was a spinning factory. There were two buildings. One was the actual textile, you know, weaving, and the other one was the spinning, and that's where I worked.
I'm going to stop you for a tape change.
Again.
This is tape 4 of an interview with Dr. Vera Laska. Dr. Laska, you were describing what happened to you when you arrived at Gross Rosen.
Yeah. Well, as I said, we were assigned to these two factories, and I was assigned to a machine which was about 5 meters long, and it had big spools, what is that, about a foot? And behind my machine, or this 5 meter long machine had I don't know how many dozens of these big spools, and they were fed from behind my machine from big bins. There were strips of cotton about, what is that, 4 inches, 5 inches wide, and half an inch thick. And they went through a row of needles, and evidently those needles divided that strip of cotton. And so then by the time I saw the cotton, it came in a very thick thread, I would say, about like my finger, and the spools were winding it up. And I had on top of these spools, there were two rows of spools, and then there was an iron rod. And the iron rod, I could stop or start. All the spools started by that rod. And of course, whenever the supervisor went to the John or looked out the window, we would stop the thing, just watching the supervisor, German supervisor, civilian. And when she started turning, we started the machine to slow down the production, you know. Or we learned very well how to, just with a touch of a finger, we could break the thread. And of course, the moment the thread was broke, we had to stop the machine and reattach the thread, and that took a little time. So that was the little thing we could do, you know, for the Allies to slow down the war production, but multiply that with the hundreds of thousands of prisoners. So it did amount to something, I hope.
What were your living conditions like there?
There, it was relatively, underlined, relatively very good, nothing like Auschwitz. First of all, we were sort of in the woods. It was a village, but we were, and the factory was in the village, but we were housed, I don't know, maybe a kilometer outside the village. And we could see woods. And once in a blue moon, we could see a wildflower. And we had one little barrack which had, I don't know, maybe 6 faucets. There were about 500 of us only, or maybe 600 or so, in several barracks. And there was one barrack for the German supervisor and a doctor. And the doctor was a Russian prisoner. And if she was the doctor, I'm Maria Teresa, maybe she was a nurse, because she didn't know from Adam. There was with us a woman whose husband was a doctor, and she had some conversation with this Russian doctor or Ukrainian, I forget. They were all Russian to us. And she said, that's, if she's a doctor, education must be strange in Russia, in the Soviet Union. But anyhow, and so that's where the clock was, in that special bag. But we could at least wash out, no hot water, but water, you know. And we were divided into separate barracks, and there were only 2 layers, not 3. And the food was relatively better. I think we got something for breakfast beside the bread came at breakfast. And sometimes we got a piece of cheese or a piece of sausage. And then for lunch was usually the soup that they brought to the factory, and we gulped it down quickly. And what was very nice, we walked to work and from work, which gave us some exercise, and sort of we could look. But we were with SS guards, nevertheless. But at least we could see color. And once in a while could see people on the street. And the factory had some German civilians, like the old Meister must have been 70. He was the top boss. He was sort of a good guy. I think that he didn't agree with all this prisoner business that he had to supervise. not that he wasn't, a Nazi, but I don't think he agreed that people should be forced to do things. Then there was the young master who was a son of a bitch, but he was lame, and that's why he was at home. And we had to watch out for him. When he came around, everybody was working like mad. And then there were local women, also additional workers, but everybody who wasn't us was a supervisor, we had to watch out for. So we had three layers of people above us, and in the door always stood the SS, with either a holster, a gun, or whatever, watching. And where they got these SS women, I don't know, we knew that some of them were maids before, washerwomen, and yet they put a uniform on them and they had the power of life and death over thousands of people. They could shoot you and nothing happened to them in the line of duty. So Gross Rosen was okay, I'm in this subdivision. Funny, I wanted to go back there too, and we couldn't find the village, and I knew the name of the village. They changed the name of the village. I don't remember what, maybe it's somewhere written down from my trip, but I didn't look at my notes yet.
What was the name of the village when you were there?
Oh, it was Zillertal, but there's no such village nowadays. And finally we found an old, we were giving up. We were in the village. I didn't recognize the village, of course. Trees grow, buildings go down, buildings go up, things look different. It's hard to believe. I hardly recognized the villa where I grew up with my grandparents. And it was a very special, big, huge villa because they changed the color, the shape, they added, they took a... So finally we found an old-timer on our drive out of the village, was just sitting on the fence, so he stopped the car. You remember? Oh, this is right here. And that factory, you're looking at it. So we went back, and there was a guard. By this time, it was about 4 in the afternoon. We were looking from 10 a.m., and the place looked like buttoned up. The guard in the window, this is still... No, this is after communism, this is after East Germany was free. And yet he is somehow behaved communistically, wouldn't let us in. And we explained, and I gave him some dollars. And because of the couple of dollars, well, I let you into the courtyard, but with a guard. And he called somebody who was a fire guard, some young man. And the fire guard took us through this big gate and into the yard, and I could look up, and I think I recognized the window, but it wouldn't let us in. It might bomb the place or whatever.
Who were, at this point, who were the other prisoners that you were with? Were they all political prisoners?
Mostly, yeah. Either that, or it's a mixed bag, you have professional people, a couple of prostitutes thrown in. Whoever was among the transport.
And were they from many different countries?
From several, yeah. We had French, we had Poles. Poles everywhere were prevalent because numerically most of the victims among the Jews and most of the prisoners were Polish. Poland was big. I don't know how many millions. And the same is true about the next place, where again I had this plush job of measuring that little ring that I was talking about.
How long were you in Gross Rosen?
We were in Gross Rosen from from July of 1944. Till briefly after the new year of 1945, because I remember Christmas and New Year's there, and shortly thereafter we were moved, evacuated. And the reason, of course, why the Germans bothered by that stage of the game to evacuate us, because if they ran away, because they're afraid of the Russian front approaching, they would be able, as long as they herded us in front of them, they were doing their duty, saving the labor force. So we were the beneficiary. Instead of being shot or abandoned or whatever, we were herded toward the center of Germany. So we ended up, I mean, my transport eventually ended up being shifted to central Germany. We were in Nordhausen for several months. And then we went on the hunger march. We didn't know toward Mauthausen, but I didn't wait until we got there.
And where were you taken after Grossrosen?
After Grossrosen, Nordhausen. The city is Nordhausen. But we were not in Nordhausen itself. We were in a village next to Nordhausen.
What was the name of the village?
And that I knew because we were looking for it. I had a very good atlas before we went on that trip. I say it was Grosswerder, or very close to it. There was a Kleinwerder, Grosswerder, or Kleinmunde, Grossmunde. It's on any detailed map. And we were in Gross, not Munde. It's very simple. If I would pick up the atlas, I would find it. What a shame that I don't remember.
What happened to you there?
There we worked in the tunnel. In the tunnel, which belonged to Camp Dora. Huge camp. Again, I don't know, I forget how many subdivisions. And there were lots of French and Belgians there, males. They had 10,000 French prisoners of war in barracks on top of the tunnel. And freight trains went into the tunnel. It was so big. To the best of my knowledge, two floors. Maybe somebody claims it was three. I don't remember. I seem to recall two floors. And huge, huge, an entire factory in the tunnel. And the one thing that they were doing there was parts, or they put together, among others, those buzz bombs, that new German invention of, what is it, flying rockets or whatever they are. V1 or V2 and V2. And there my job was, why I call it plus job, I could stand or I could sit even and measure with a micrometer, which is a little gadget. You measure the thickness of a little metallic ring. Diameter was the word that I was looking for. Twice the radius is a diameter. Okay. So I was measuring the diameter and the thickness of the ring. And all the good ones were supposed to go, I don't know, to this bin, and the bad one to the other bin. So I was very just and divided them 50-50. One went here, one went there. And Mr. Churchill said after the war that ever since they put political prisoners in the tunnel, the buzz bombs didn't work so well. Many fell down and didn't explode. So I take a millionth of a millionth percentage credit for that.
Were you actively doing something to sabotage the bombs?
That's what I'm telling you. I just pretended to measure. I mean, one went here, one went there. Good, bad, I couldn't care less. Oh, I did care. You know, I did want to measure and put the good ones here and bad ones there.
Was that an organized effort with other prisoners, or were you?
Oh, most people. Slowdown was an instinctive thing. Whenever you watch the supervisor turn his back or look out the window or go to the jam, whatever, you immediately slow down. First of all, you saved energy, self-preservation. And second, the hell with them, you know, they want me to do this, I won't do it, or I slow down. The moment they came back, you had to work, or else, you know, because they could take your food away, they could beat you.
About how old were you at this point?
How what?
How old were you at this point that you were working in
well,
the tunnel?
Well, you add it up. I must have been about, what, 17 or so.
And what were your living conditions like at Dora Nordhausen?
at Nordhausen, this must have been a really desperate times by now, the Germans, because the village wasn't set up for prisoners at all. These French prisoners of war were in barracks on top of the tunnel, so that was part of whoever did the tunnel. And then they got these new, I don't know why they got us there, they needed extra work. This is about February of 45, January, February. We were housed in a house which must have been something like a community center, because we were bedded down on the floor of something that like a theater. There was a stage, actually, with a curtain, you know. So that's how we were bedded down, on the floor, one next to another, like two of us on that rug, you know. Some mattresses did have straw. We did have a blanket. And the food was mostly that so-called soup with potatoes. Wasn't much better than Gross Rosen. Because this was really the tail end of the war by this time. The Germans knew chances are nil that they would win the war, you know.
And the sanitary conditions there?
The what?
The sanitary conditions?
Well, we had to stand in line for the john. There were maybe a couple of johns. I don't remember. I don't see them. I know that somewhere, for the first time, I saw johns in a strange shape. I forget where it was, whether it was right here, that I later saw in the Orient. The bowls had a completely different shape. But I don't see it. I see the stage. I see a little tiny room, not bigger than maybe twice my couch, three times my couch, which must have been a dressing room, which a friend of mine and I sort of declared, that's our room. That was it. Nobody discovered it. We discovered it. And we took our mattresses there. And I remember getting hold some scraps of newspaper with a picture of a horse. I don't particularly like horses. But somehow put the picture of a horse on the wall. That was art. That was a sign of another life. But we didn't enjoy our room too long, because then we were taking on that march, the hunger march.
Were you still with the original four members of the Auschwitz group?
Yes, we still were together until the hunger march, at which point I told Verica, the one who is in Yugoslavia. It's so hard to believe that Verica is more than 60 years old. Anyhow, and I said, watch me, I am going to lots of good confusion. Because it was such a mess that you wouldn't believe, with German refugees, army refugees, our refugees, Jewish refugees, you name it, people going with pieces of furniture on top of a horse one way, and others went. It was unbelievable on the highways. Military machinery, and we all had to go into the ditch because the military had to go through. So I said, lots of confusion, I'm going to try to escape. And I wasn't the first one, you know. And I said, if you want to run with me, don't move from my side. Because if the chance comes, I go. You are there, you're not there, I go. Don't move from me. And she did. Because we got to this village, and there was a cauldron, but cauldron, you know, like they make plum. Oh, you wouldn't know about plum preserves in Europe. Anyhow, big cauldron of boiled potatoes. And not for us, for the German refugees who were coming through running from the Russians. And our group just went zoom on that cauldron of boiled potatoes, including Verica. And I went in the other direction over the fence. And later on, of course, we met, and she said she was crying for 2 days. I said, well, you were stupid. I told you, stick to me every moment. But the potatoes. I said, so you had potatoes, I had freedom. So what? Anyhow, she's, well, so that's how I liberated myself.
When was it that the death march began, and what were you told by the Germans?
Told nothing, get off your ass and march. They didn't announce we are going here or we're going there. We're just going.
And when was this?
So this must have been March 1945, but what day of March, I don't know. What a shame that I don't know.
How long did you march before you escaped?
We marched at least 3 nights, so 3 days and 3 nights. And meanwhile, you know, they tried to bed us down in all kinds of what they call those big houses for the hay. I usually am not at loss for words. Where do you keep the horses and the cows and then the hay?
Barn.
Huge barns. And we were lucky because they might have some straw. And we slept helter-skelter, you know. And once we just stayed outside and went bitter cold. Many people died on the way.
Were you with, at that point, just political prisoners or all kinds of people?
By that time, we were so mixed that, and we didn't ask, who are you? And out of Auschwitz, we no longer had triangles. They didn't want us to wear triangles because we were mingling with Germans in the factory. You know. So it was a mixed bag, and Poles all over the place.
How did the SS guards treat you on that march?
Roughly, and of course, the worst treatment came to those who couldn't march anymore, and they would sit down. And the crowd would continue. And those who stayed behind were shot. We heard the shots. And we saw, you know, these lines were so long. They must have been miles and miles. And I was surprised that they shot people in view of the German population. And there were people to the right, to the left, dead horses, dead people. And you didn't know whether they are German refugees or whether they are Jews or whether they are just one of us. There wouldn't be one of us because we were marching on and we would leave a few behind, and then you heard the shots. And no food. And you can barely walk. Miserable shoes. Most shoes were too big or too small.
What were you wearing?
I don't know, some kind of, I'm sure it wasn't those damn black shoes anymore. I have no idea. But I had something on my feet, and I had two shoes that matched, because many people had one right shoe, one left shoe that didn't match, which is horrible. But no stockings, and that is something that's very rough on your feet. If you don't have something between your skin and the shoe, at least to me it's very rough. And so whatever, if we could get hold of some rag or even paper, you know, to get a piece of paper was not like get a piece of paper. Where? From where? Not even on the Johns did we find newspapers, because that was what the Germans used at that time. They cut squares like that from newspaper. And not even that was on the John, so that we wouldn't find any news from the newspaper. So when we found a little piece of paper, put in the shoe quickly. But how long does that last? Some people had stockings organized somewhere.
Do you remember the reaction of people as you were marching by, of some of the townspeople?
No, my dear, everybody had their own trouble. Sometimes you would say, where are you coming from? Who are you? Once in a blue moon. Or we asked. But most of us, I remember marching, just keeping my mouth shut, because even to open your mouth took energy. Plus, we probably didn't give a damn. But when we saw German refugees, I remember a feeling of joy. So that's what finally you're getting, what's coming to you. because all Germans be stuck into the same bank at that stage of the game. That's a normal human reaction.
Did you know what was happening with the war?
Well, we knew that they are getting a tremendous beating from the Russians because we were going from the east toward the west. But to tell you how without news we were, the invasion was June 6, 1944. Of course, we knew, quote-unquote, by May there was an invasion, but it was wishful thinking. But we found out for sure, that reliably, that there had been an invasion in June, in October. That we really knew, not just rumors, you know. Was lots of latrine rumors. Latrine was the cultural center everywhere.
Can you describe what happened to you when you escaped?
Yeah. Well, I fell into a pile of manure. And I remembered some old saying that manure, if you step into it, it's good luck. Did you hear that? No? That is all over Europe. They've said, oh, you stepped into dog do, that's good luck. So I said, good luck. Well, I got myself out of there and ran while everybody was around that potato cauldron. And there was one big building, and I ran into that big building. It was a huge open door, and it looked like a barn. It was a barn. And it was one of those double barns, you know, there was something on the right side, something on the left side. And the empty sort of corridor in the middle. And I ran, and there was a ladder standing there. And I ran up that ladder, and there was lots of straw. And why, I'll never know, I did one of the smartest thing in my life, I think. As I was up there, I took the ladder and moved it, and it fell against the other side of the barn. You understand? Like this. Here was the ladder. Here was the little empty space. Here was the other part of my... And I moved the ladder and went this way. Okay. And I stayed there quiet as a mouse. And I heard some voices in German, I mean in good German, not Lager German, saying, Sonja, search, search, Sonja. And I think, Sonja? So the woman's name, Sonja. Huh? It was a dog's name was Sonja. And they wanted a dog, and the dog came, and I'm lost. And the dog was barking upwards, so the peasant, or the farmer, went up that ladder looking, and there was nobody there. I was on the other side, so straw all over me, you know, quiet. And that was it. And I stayed there, nobody came to that barn for 4.5 days.
I'm going to stop you there for a tape change.
No.
Yes. Of an interview with Dr. Vera Laska. Dr. Laska, you were describing what happened when you were in the barn and you were discovered. What happened next?
Well, what happened next, 4.5 long days later. Meanwhile, by the way, all the time I heard shooting, but I couldn't tell right, left, up, down, shooting and all kinds of shooting. I cannot tell what's shot from a revolver or a gun or something bigger. So the war somehow went over that village. And after 4.5 days, Ukrainian forced laborer came down to the barn and started hollering, "Woman, come down! War kaput! Hitler kaput!" Okay? And first I didn't believe it, but then he said, "Woman, come down, war kaput, I have bread." I came down. That's as simple as that. 4.5 days. And before that, you know, I was hungry. So then we exchanged a few rather interesting words. And he went that way and I went that way. He was still afraid of his German farmer boss, and he said he has to go now. And I said, "Where do I go now?" So I started, he said, "The soldiers are there, go there." So I went that way. And suddenly I see there were Russian soldiers with Russian machinery, which I immediately knew, of course, because they had the five-edged star. And five-edged star, to me, was communist. Except they were Americans. Which, idiotically, the American army had the Russian star in white. But who knew? White or red, it was the five-edged star. So I somehow managed to make the few steps there. And practically, I didn't collapse, but I practically collapsed, and I was blabbering the few words of Russian, saying, "Water, water," in Russian. I figured same as in Czech, "Voda, voda." They looked at me like, I don't know, the Loch Ness Monster or something. So that's how I liberated myself, or that's how the Americans liberated me, if you wish.
Do you have any idea where you were, what the nearest town was?
No, unfortunately. And every time I think of that, I could kick myself. Well, this was in a meadow, but I don't know next to what village. Next to that village where I ran away from the potato. From the boiled potatoes. That American officer was eating a beautiful red apple. And I just grabbed it practically from his mouth. He looked strangely. That was his first encounter. And then later on we talked and he said, "I didn't know that women were in concentration camps." So, New Yorker. Yeah, time. Okay.
What was your medical condition like at that point?
Medical?
Yeah, what were you physically?
Well, I was about, I weighed about 90 pounds. I rattled when I walked on the bones. But I felt fit and I had some trouble, you know, neglected teeth. But no TB, no other trouble. We all had big physical checkups when we got home. And nothing was wrong. Knock on wood.
And where did you go?
Oh, I went back to Prague, you know, home grounds.
How did you get there?
Well, I met up with some former resistors from Prague. At Dora, and there were two of them were doctors, so they got the brilliant idea of organizing a car. Organizing, by the way, means to steal, okay? Organizing a car, and they also organized some painter who could paint, you know, very official looking, beautiful letters, Czechoslovak Red Cross on top, on four side or two side. Then we went to the Dora office of the SS. This was very freshly the end of the war in that region, officially not yet the end of the war, April. And we got all the files into the car. And there was one, two, three of them, and me is four, and one more guy, I don't remember, the five was. We didn't fit the car. So two of them organized motorcycles. So we had two motorcycles and Czechoslovak Red Cross car. You know, the two motorcycles played the escort. And we just, which way is Prague? That way. You know, and we went. And we got through to every American checkpoint. You know, they saluted Czech Red Cross. until we got to a Czech border, and there were the Ruskis and say, what Czech Red Cross? Papers, no papers. Well, luckily one of those doctors was smart and he had some, I don't know, booze, vodka, not vodka, whatever they said in Germany, and a couple of bottles to the Ivans, and we went through, and by 9th of May we were in Prague. The uprising just ended in Prague. We came for the tail end. And from then on the story takes a very happy turn in the sense that pretty soon I got, well, I worked for the war crime investigation, which was interesting for about a year. And then my professor said, we'll send you to America on a scholarship. And that's where the long happy end follows, you know, in the United States.
Let me take you back just a moment. You came to Prague, and how did you get the job with the war crimes investigation?
Oh, because this doctor who was the head honcho in this Czechoslovak Red Cross venture was a friend of the head of the Czech War Crime Commission, which was by then founded in those days. And he was an ex-concentration camp person also, of course. He later ended up as in the United, employee of the United Nations as the governor of Madagascar, a Bohunk, or a Czech, I shouldn't say Bohunk, a Czech governor of Madagascar for many years.
What was his name?
Cebe Habersky. And retired to a farm in Vermont, but he's dead too by now, unfortunately. Anyhow, so it was this concentration camp group, really, most of us, who were in the war crime investigation. And so were the members of the French, Norwegian, Danish, whatever, war crime investigation teams. See, 99% ex-concentration camp people, the only reliable people at that point.
So you were working in Prague?
Oh, yeah.
And what were you doing for them?
Well, we were gathering testimonies from former prisoners about the SS in Dachau, Buchenwald, what have you. Didn't do Auschwitz, I wonder why. Anyhow, I remember Dachau first, that was the first camp, Buchenwald and some others, Sachsenhausen.
What was your role?
I was the executive secretary, believe it or not. I had an office, huge, and in the corner was a desk, and there I sat in eyeglasses, which I didn't need, and always black or dark blue, so I would look older. But I had a very good, beautiful team who helped me out. I don't know, maybe they just wanted a woman as executive secretary, I don't know. And of course, the board of directors met every week, 12 of them. And those were just about all, again, ex-concentration, you know, Dachau, Buchenwald, Sachsenhausen, Neuengamme, whatever, you know, Auschwitz. And there were some high military officials, and there was one judge, there was Milada Horáková. If there was another woman, I don't remember. I was so taken by Dr. Milada Horáková, who was a member of parliament by that time, who was in Ravensbrück during that war, and then after the communists came in, she was executed in the big Slansky trials of the early 50s.
Were you aware of which trials they were preparing for?
Of course, because I was sort of calling the shots and organizing things, stuff like that.
Do you recall any who was being tried?
No, I don't remember, because these were people from camps where I haven't been. And even when, for instance, I never knew names of guards. You didn't say, what's your name, guard? You got a slap in the face. And why would they tell you? And why would they tell you the real name? People know the name of Mengele. And I would bet more than a nickel that most people who say, I remember Mengele, they don't remember him. They remember an officer with the riding crop who stood there. I don't think they, because when we arrived, there were officers. How the hell do you know it was Mengele? Very few people really knew Mengele. There were some prisoners, doctors, for instance, when he came to do his experiments in the hospital. They knew this is Dr. Mengele. But us peasants in the other blocks, very few.
What do you remember about taking people's testimonies at that time from Buchenwald and Dachau?
Well, I would interview them. First of all, we interviewed people about the German supervisors, the SS. We also interviewed a few people who claimed that they were in concentration camps, a new angle for you, never been there. Maybe they were black marketeers. Maybe they collaborated with the Germans. Maybe they were Sudeten Germans. So those were the easy ones because we would quiz them. Oh yeah, you were in Dachau, and I had a plan of Dachau with all the numbers of the blocks and how many yards and so on. And which block were you in? And what was your number? And who was in the next block? And what happened on Thursday, January 5th, you know? And so on. So that was one type, this sort of detective work. And the others, you knew Supervisor Schultz? Okay, what do you know about Supervisor Schultz? He beat people. Did you see it? Yes, I saw it. When was it? How did he beat him? Did he step on the guy's neck? Did he throw him down? Okay, sign here. You know, that was that type of interview.
Who were most of the people you were talking to? Were they also fellow political prisoners?
Well, some were, because they were the ones who were in Dachau and Sachsenhausen and so on. We had a separate group of the students, you know, who were mostly in Sachsenhausen, but also transferred. And then this was typed up. At that time, everything was no dictaphone, everything. Take notes, and usually with me somebody else also taking notes, and then we put two notes together. And then we had secretaries who typed it up, and the guy had to either wait or come back, sign it, notarize it, because this is Europe, you know, everything had to be notarized. And then we sent it wherever. We sent it in Germany, where the trials were being prepared at that time. We had files this high. Then I left for America after a year.
So you were also studying at the time, is that right?
Yeah.
Where were you studying?
At Charles University.
And how did you arrange to come to America?
Oh, I didn't. My professors, bless their soul, decided that I should go to America for one reason, to study American history and bring it back to become an assistant in American history, in order to balance out the new chair of Soviet history, which was by that time approved, you see. So it was sort of inner politics behind it. And so two of us were sent. One went to, I don't know where he went, maybe he went to Colombia. And then stayed in the States after the communists took over and taught for many years in Buffalo. What's in Buffalo? University of New York, Buffalo branch, or University of Buffalo. I don't know, but it was town of Buffalo. And when they asked me where I would like to go, I said, I want to go to Chicago. So they sent me to Chicago because President Masaryk taught there. And President Benesh, when he became an exiled president, taught there. So I figured good for them is good for me. So that's how I got to the University of Chicago.
And when was this that you came to America?
Well, I started the winter semester of 47 in Chicago.
And once you were here, what did you study?
Well, at Chicago at that time, full program was three courses. That's a trimester system. So I took two courses in American history and one for fun. So the first one for fun course I took was American education. And then there's all kinds of other things that I was interested in, like Chinese history. All I knew was that China is big and it's somewhere there, you know. and all kinds of other courses. All the two American history, one for fun. Because I had a, well, that's beside the point. Okay.
Mm-hmm. And did you earn your degree?
I got my degree finally in 1959, got a PhD in American history with a minor in Latin America.
You were also married in America.
Yeah.
And when did that happen?
Yeah, that happened in 1949.
And what is your husband's name?
His name is Andy. And his last name is Laska, which is the only reason I married the guy, because Laska means love in Czech. And he's from Cleveland, Ohio.
And you had a son several years later. What was his name?
My son's name was Thomas Václav, but he died at age 20.
How did he die?
In an automobile accident. And then we adopted a 12-year-old from Costa Rica, and his name is Paul.
Did you
and he's a phys ed major.
Did you talk to your husband and your sons about your experience, your wartime experiences?
Very little. I don't think they really, really were interested. This was one chapter that somehow, not intentionally, but it just so happened, it was closed. Don't forget, here was a European girl who came into a miraculous new world with so many new interests. American history, which always fascinated me. I mean, always. Ever since I stuck my nose into it, it fascinated me. It still fascinates me. So very little, and there was all kinds of other things to discuss, so very little talk. As a matter of fact, I don't think my son Paul ever read my book. But then he didn't read my book about the women in the revolution or about Benjamin Franklin. He is interested in phys ed. So, and my intellectual son was dead, because I started writing after he died. I didn't write. In 72, I started my column in the local paper, I started reviewing books, and I started writing books. Just do something that would take my mind away from that, because that was much worse than Auschwitz.
In the 1970s, you wrote a book about your war experience. What drove you to do that? What motivated you to do that?
No, that was in the 80s. That was my 1, 2, 3, 4, and that's my fifth book.
What motivated you to write that?
I tell you, because so many people who don't know beans about the subject teach about Holocaust, and no, not even a dog was barking about the 5 million non-Jewish people. Resistance? What resistance? You mean the war, the soldiers? No! The national resistance in France, in Norway, in Denmark, there are shelves of books written about each in Europe, and here nobody knows. So I dropped what I was doing at that time. I was doing, and I have about two-thirds ready, a biography of Abigail Adams, fascinating woman. And as I was on the floor of my study sorting chapter 15 or whatever, it hit me, you know, like good Catholics have a vision. I had a vision. I'm an idiot. What am I doing with Abigail Adams? I should write about the women. Nobody's writing about the women. And nobody's writing about the resistance. So that's how the book, I scooped it together and put it away. Yeah, I know. We are finishing.
Just a few more questions.
Yeah.
What is your current profession now?
Well, I'm a professor emerita. I teach only, I'm officially retired from teaching. So I teach only the fall semester. And I have a column in the local papers. So that is basically it. And I lecture quite a bit, mostly about either women or concentration camps, Holocaust resistance, and so on.
Looking back on your experience, to what do you attribute your survival?
It's a combination of healthy body, which I was blessed with at that time, good luck, without that, nothing else, and in a way, determination, in that order. Or maybe luck comes first, because without luck, you could be healthy and determined, and you went up the chimney.
You wrote at the in the epilogue of your book that your memories remain unchanged, that you cultivate them in solitude because people around you wouldn't comprehend. But can you just explain that a little?
They wouldn't. You wouldn't, and you work in this field. Because there is something that's very hard to express in books, and Eli Wiesel cannot express it, and Primo Levi cannot express as good as they are, and several women who are even better cannot express it. It's the constant feeling in your stomach of fear. I cannot express this either. I'm trying to approximate it. The smells you cannot reproduce. And the whole atmosphere of this, what I call phantasmagorical atmosphere. Dante's hell would be nursery school compared with it. To live not every day, but every hour, every minute, every second, that you don't know whether in next moment you won't be marching up the chimney or being shot or die of typhoid fever or something. Nobody can convey that.
Last question. Do you have a message for future generations based on your own experience?
Well, yes, I definitely do. And that was the reason why I'm teaching a course of the same title as my book is. And maybe if you allow me, I will read that from the book, all right? This is called Women in the Resistance and in the Holocaust, and I must show off this fabulous picture of a woman on a swastika, which I think expresses it very well. And what I'm going to read you are just a few sentences from the epilogue to the books to the book. Celebrate life as much as you can without hurting others, for too much of it has been wasted through sheer madness. Place flowers of sympathy and sorrow on the non-existent graves of millions who were annihilated through cruelty and with malice aforethought. Keep in mind the victims of the Holocaust and their bones scattered all over Europe, unmarked with crosses or David's star. For lest you forget, their sacrifices will have been in vain, and humanity will tumble into the abyss of evil again. Honor the memory of those fallen and strengthen your soul against repeated bereavement of mankind so that you can look with a clear conscience into the eyes of your children. Weep not for the survivors of the purgatory called Holocaust, for theirs is the ultimate glory in triumph. They outlived the evil of their tormentors and by their very lives overcame it. Learn from them, for nobody, but nobody, knows how to savor the sunlight and the raindrops, the free flight of the birds and the smile of the flowers, as those of us who were once denied dignity, beauty, and the simplest things in life that make it worth living.
Dr. Laska, thank you very much.
You are most welcome. My pleasure.
This is tape 6 of an interview with Dr. Vera Laska. Dr. Laska?
My name is Vera Laska, and this is my boyfriend and husband of 40X years, Andy J. Laska.
Mr. Laska, how did you meet your wife?
Well, we were both students at the University of Chicago, where I met Vera, and we had a similar background. And we fell in love. Then we got married and spent a wonderful 40 years together.
And you were also involved in the resistance?
During the war, my parents came from Czechoslovakia, and they were put into jail. My father stayed in jail for over 3.5 years. I was 12 years old when me and my brother, when we were put into jail first, and then we were sent into a coal mine, and then I escaped from there and joined the resistance, was wounded twice, survived the war, and then left for the United States and Mexico, where my father was ambassador of Czechoslovakia. Eventually I ended up at the University of Chicago, where I met Vera.
Did she talk to you about her wartime experiences? Did you share that?
Not really.
Well, we didn't have to. We both knew what it meant. And so it was not in great detail.
Is there a message that you have for future generations based on your and her experiences in the wartime?
I think that the world has to act before such wars happen again, or before countries start killing each other. And the United States is the only country that has the power to do that. And I'm hoping that with Madeleine Albright as our Secretary of State today, that she will induce such attitudes and that we will agree with them and do it.
Thank you very much.
You're most welcome.
Go ahead.
Well, this is a charm bracelet which has all kinds of souvenirs of my happier life after the camps, but the reason why you're seeing it is this ring here.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Which is now encased in plastic for reason of preservation, but inside you see a little ring, looks like duraluminium, like silver color, and it is part of the buzz bombs that the Germans sent over London during World War II, and there must have been dozens of those little rings as parts of the, as they call them, V2. And at the concentration camp annex of the tunnel at Nordhausen-Dora, my job was measuring these rings by the hundreds with a micrometric screw. And of course, that was a very easy job to sabotage, because instead of measuring the exact measurements, we just said, oh, this is, doesn't fit, and we discarded half of them. There were several of us who did the same job in the tunnel at Dora camp. This is a photograph, believe it or not, of myself in 1945, very serious. My hair is about 1 year old.
And can you just say your
My name is Vera Laska, and this was taken in Prague, Czechoslovakia, in 1945.
Go ahead.
My name is Vera Laska, and here are two of my literary children related to the Holocaust. Women in the Resistance and in the Holocaust is my fifth book, and Nazism, Resistance, and Holocaust in World War II, a bibliography, was the next.